Now, the next point I'd like a family to understand, and we are only on number 6. Whoa. 25 to go. That the deficits in these executive abilities chiefly arise from problems with brain development. So we're going to do a very quick 3-minute crash course on causation. What causes ADHD? Multiple things. But all of them fall into the realm of biology. We now know that you cannot turn a normal child into an ADHD child by exposing them to any social influence. It's not possible. Not going to happen. We also know that these causes can interact with each other. I'll show you a slide on that. Very interesting. Multiple biological hazards may be interacting to produce the disorder. We now know where in the head this is coming from. So if someone tells you we don't know where in the brain it is, they're wrong. Go to the library. Please read a journal. We know that social factors alone do not cause this disorder. But social factors are very important. Kindly do not leave this room and say that Russ said that social factors don't matter. I didn't say that. I said they don't cause it. But they do matter in 3 important ways. First, the resources you will have available to treat this child are very much a function of the social environment around you. Second, the impairments your child will experience are very much a part of the situation. You can rearrange environments so they're less impairing. Third, comorbidity. We know that other disorders that link up with ADHD have some social contributors to them. Oppositional disorder, conduct disorder, anxiety disorder, and depression all have social contributions. Indeed, 40 to 50% of the variation in those disorders is the social environment. So while the social environment doesn't cause this disorder, I would want families to understand that doesn't mean it's not important or irrelevant. It's important for several other very important reasons. Now, we know that a third of all ADHD is acquired, not genetic, and that most of those acquired cases occur during pregnancy. And these are the things that we have found that are likely to cause ADHD in the unborn child, because all of these disrupt the formation of the frontal lobe of the brain. But we also know that about 5% of ADHD can occur after birth as a result of various traumas and infections and other things that can affect ongoing brain development in these 5 crucial areas. And it is the acquired cases that are most likely to have seizures. We know that lead poisoning, treating leukemia, that's right, the treatments for leukemia can cause ADHD. We know that strep bacteria contributes a small amount of ADHD. Why would the strep bacteria do that? Because the strep bacteria has a protein on the outside of it, and that protein is identical to proteins that occur in the brain. And therefore, your immune system attacks your brain. So it's not the bacteria. It's the fact that the immune system can't distinguish the bacteria from nerve cells. And this damages certain parts of the brain, and one of those parts causes ADHD. It's not a very common problem, but it can happen. We know the brain regions that are giving rise to ADHD, and we know that in 2/3 of children, the reasons for these brain regions being smaller has to do with genetics, about which I will say more in a moment. But let's at least go through these brain regions. The 5 regions of the brain that are interconnected to each other and give rise to this disorder are the right frontal lobe, right over here, especially over the eyebrow, and the connections from there deep into the brain called the basal ganglia. I'll show it to you in a moment. And then there are connections from the central part of the brain back to the very primitive structure at the back of the brain known as the cerebellum. That is also smaller. And then there's a very special part of the brain that lies right between the eyes in the midline, going back on the walls of the 2 hemispheres as they come together. And deep inside, on those walls, is the anterior cingulate. And that is where the emotional dysregulation originates. Finally, there is the corpus callosum, which allows the 2 hemispheres to talk to each other, but it's no surprise. If the front part of the brain is smaller, then the corpus callosum has to be smaller. The size of this network is directly related to severity of ADHD, and in children who inherit the disorder, these parts of the brain are about 3 to 10% smaller. That's it, just 3 to 10%. Doesn't sound like much, and it isn't, but it's enough to cause this disorder. More importantly, it's not enough to use brain imaging for diagnosis. These differences are so small and so subtle that you could not use them to classify people, which is why no brain imaging technique, including Dr. Amon's SPECT scanning, is of any value for diagnosis. We know that there are very few gender differences in these networks, though there are some that are interesting. I won't talk about them today. And we know that these differences are relatively persistent over time. The structural differences will normalize by about 16 to 18 years of age, that is, the size of the brain, but the functioning of the brain will not. And contrary to Tom Cruise and the Scientologists, these brain differences have nothing to do with giving medication to these children. So let me show you the parts of the brain we're talking about very quickly. Let me get my cursor up here on the screen. This is the right orbital frontal area, right here. This part of the brain projects back in between those two hemispheres. There's a structure you can't see. It's right about in here, and that's the anterior cingulate. And then there are projections back into the basal ganglia right here, and then back to the cerebellum right there. And it's the right side of the cerebellum in the central part that's smaller. Indeed, most interesting is that research has found in the last 2 years that the parents and the brothers and sisters of ADHD children also have smaller neural networks in exactly these areas, except for one, and that is the cerebellum, which tells us that of all of these differences, most of them are part of the family phenotype. Even if the family member never shows the disorder, they carry these patterns of underdevelopment. What may make the disorder break through into full disorder is that something happened to that cerebellum. That's an interesting possibility. Remains to be replicated, but that's a finding from research at UCLA. So what's going on? The brain is not developing on time. We know that from the Montreal, New York, Washington multi-site study, in which 223 ADHD and normal children were scanned serially over a period of about 10 years. This is the first developmental neuroimaging study. And what did it find? That the frontal lobe of the brain, primarily, is about 2 to 3 years delayed in its growth. This is a study of growth, not function, just brain size. And what you're looking at is a top-down view of the brain, and these are the frontal lobes. So there's about a 2 to 3 year delay in your brain development, and you can see it in the right and in the left hemisphere here as well. So this was a groundbreaking study demonstrating that the brain is late in these crucial executive areas to develop. Now, the better parent is going to be asking me about this. This is not the frontal lobe. What the heck is that? Right? That's back where your visual cortex is. Why would that be involved in ADHD? The second executive function is visual imagery. And that's involved in visual imagery. This part of the brain developed too early. This is the motor strip, and it developed about 2 to 3 years earlier, and it's where the hyperactivity is coming from. So you've got a motor strip that's generating behavior and a frontal lobe that's not regulating it. So I would want parents to understand that this is a brain-based disorder, and that it results in a maturational lag and how rapidly these parts of the brain are developing. I want the family coming to my clinic to understand that most of these differences originate in genetics, but that about a third of the male patients that we see may well have acquired their ADHD. In girls, it's far less than that. In fact, it's fair to say that the vast majority of girls have the genetic type of the disorder. But about a third of the boys may have acquired their disorder. We know that ADHD runs in families and have for 40 years. Here are the risks if you have an ADHD child. 25 to 35% of their brothers and sisters will have the same disorder. If you're an identical twin, that risk is 78 to 92%. Notice that the closer people are genetically related, the higher the risk if one has the disorder, that the other's going to have the disorder. Now, if we bring in their mothers and evaluate them, upwards of one-fifth of their mothers are still adults with ADHD. And nearly a third of their fathers are currently ADHD. And if you add those two together, it means that there's a 50% chance that one of the parents sitting across your desk has the same disorder, probably never diagnosed. Which is why we now teach clinicians that you should be screening every parent that brings a child to your clinic. Oh, and by the way, if you're an adult with ADHD, 40 to 54% of your children will have the same disorder. That is a profoundly genetic disorder. Nearly half of the offspring of adults with ADHD have ADHD as well. We know from twin studies that the vast majority of ADHD is due to genetic differences. On average, 80% of the differences in people in this room in their ADHD symptoms are due to differences in their genes. And in the last few studies, it was as high as human height, about 91%. Twin studies allow us to calculate how much of a trait is due to the rearing environment, and it's zero. All 40 twin studies published in the last 20 years have shown that the rearing environment has no influence on this trait. Yet the public believes that ADHD originates in bad parenting. The twin studies also tell us that there's a small percentage of ADHD that's arising from non-genetic causes, and those are those acquired injuries that we talked about earlier.